very much, and good morning. Historically, as I've been out on the corporate lecture circuit, I begin with a much more cerebral approach to the psychology of success, and particularly as it relates to marketing. But since you've already been there and done that, I thought I'd actually go ahead and open with something a little bit different.
Is a blow shoots up through the stony ground. There's no room, no space to rent in this town. You're out of luck, and the reason that you had to care, the traffic is stuck, and you're not moving anywhere. You thought you found a friend, take you out of this place, someone you can lend a hand in return for grace. It's a beautiful day. Sky falls, you feel like it's a beautiful day. So let it get away on the road. But you got in the mud, in the maze of her imagination, your love is down. Even if that doesn't ring true, you've been all over, and it's been all over you. It's a beautiful day.
We would open with something just a little bit different to kind of kick things off this year, but actually it's a little more interactive type of keynote. You're going to see I've actually got a few more brushes and a couple more canvases, so I just wanted to see by a quick show of hands, who here can draw? All right, I too am a big fan of analytics, metrics, and evidence-based marketing, so I'd say it's maybe just a little less than half of you. Actually, don't feel bad. I ask that question of every audience that I speak to, regardless whether it is financial services, engineering, attorneys, retail, manufacturing, even sometimes marketing. I will rarely, if you've never get even one brave soul that's going to raise their hand and say that they can, in fact, draw. But if I were to go down to your high schools, your secondary schools, anywhere throughout the world, and I were to ask those students who can draw, I'm going to statistically, on average, get between almost 8 to 10% of those students are going to say that they can, in fact, draw. But if I were to go down to your preschools, any preschool, and I would say, hey, kids, who here can draw? What's the response that I'm going to get? No. 100% of the time, these kids, oftentimes even our own children, are practically bursting at the seams, just dying to share with me their creative energy. At what age, then, do you think that creative river that once did flow so freely and almost effortlessly through each and every one of us, what age do you think it started to dry up? Yeah, young, early. Pablo Picasso said, you know, every child is an artist. The challenge is ultimately how to remain an artist once we grow up. How to retain that childlike passion, that childlike ability to differentiate, to creatively solve challenges, to navigate ambiguity or even master complexity and ultimately plug it back into our adult life. Plug it back into your strategy, your storytelling, and even that unique consumer experience. Now, Bono, the lead singer of a small band out of Dublin called U2, he was being interviewed upon his introduction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. They're asking him a little bit about his experiences with music, really where it was born from, but truly where he saw the future of music ultimately going. And he said something that I found fascinating. He said, even though music is comprised of, for the most part, 8 fairly basic notes, he said that their best music, collaboratively as a band, oftentimes took place in the space between the notes. And so that's one to explore a little bit further here at this year's Client Summit. Is that space of excellence, that space of opportunity that takes place between the notes of conventional analytical data or even business wisdom in the context of marketing. I wanted to share with you how I, as an artist, go about harnessing my own almost natural creativity and effort towards building a painting, a picture, a strategy, a vision for the future that even has the potential to differentiate from all the other great artwork out on the marketplace, but certainly and more importantly for you as CMOs and marketing directors, how you can also tap into a wealth of new ideas, creativity, innovation to plug back into your consumer experience to transcend the commoditization of what has that potential to become an interaction in this social, mobile, and cloud environment. Defy your competitors, even this channel agnosticity, and actually use this uncertainty, both politically and economically and competitively, to go on the offensive, to brand yourself as that category of one. Now, contrary to what my fourth grade teacher taught me, I actually do encourage post-breakfast daydreaming. And if you like, doodling, drawing, instant messaging, texting, tweeting, Snapchatting, over the course of this presentation here, because I do like to get outside of that old school dinosaur model that learning or academics need to take place within the four walls of an institution. Start growing your ideas, pinging them off of maybe some of your colleagues who weren't able to be here in Vegas this week, off of your friends and family that weren't able to join you here, to connect ideas a little bit differently. Did anybody chance bring with them to this morning's session, business session, their box of Crayolas? You guys remember these bad boys? That box of 64 with the sharpener in the back. Yeah. So when I'm brainstorming with sales and marketing teams, we're looking for new ways to organically grow channels of revenue, streamline operational efficiencies amidst this data, even to anticipate proactively anticipate emerging trends in future markets. I actually require, at that point, that all meeting notes are taken using Creo, because I'm not looking for the absolute most efficient form of a writing implement, but I'm looking to go in search of those bold, almost new, courageous, creative ideas. Historically, I've found Crayola's got that better chance to foster. Incidentally, a study at Yale University has shown this one of the top 20 most recognizable smells. It's in the adult human experience. I mean, that man sits up there with what? Dill pickles? Your morning coffee? It's even shown that just the smell alone of Crayola has been proven to reduce blood pressure in adults downwards 10 points. So if you've had any particular frustration in your marketing department with budgets being cut back, being forced to do more and more with less and less, just go ahead and pull out your box of crayons and take a drag. See, that doesn't ease your frazzled nerves just a bit. But I could teach anyone to draw, because drawing's a learned skill. Exactly like reading, writing, or arithmetic, yet because virtually every facet of our very industrial factory educational system, even oftentimes up through our hierarchical corporate structure, is set up and designed to reward and affirm almost only all critical, logical, analytical thinking. It's oftentimes been those creative skills, those abilities by which to be able to navigate some of this ambiguity or master some of these complexities, have almost just simply atrophied over time, from the time that we were little. Now, certainly, of course, painting or drawing, that's not the ultimate goal. That's not what by itself is going to create breakthrough opportunities for you or your brand or your marketing efforts. But I think it is actually through activities like drawing, traveling, experiencing diversity, experiencing different cultures, maybe even different private product or service industries altogether, that we're able to tap into that creative side of our mind. I think it's only through purposefully and intentionally tapping into the creative side of our mind that we are going to come up with new and different ideas that your valued consumers didn't even yet know that they needed, by breaking outside of business as usual. In some cases, I think it's even going to mean breaking outside of our comfort zone. So I want to do kind of a thought leader experiment under that guise of breaking outside of our comfort zone. There's a television show. It's hosted by a gentleman by the name of Joe Rogan. The title of the show is actually called Fear Factory. Now, for those of you who aren't entirely familiar with this particular show, I'm going to give you kind of the Cliff Notes version of what it is. Basically, in an effort to challenge these individuals to break outside of their comfort zone, they would have them perform these just absolutely outrageous different stunts, sometimes eat or consume some very challenging food items, and sometimes even do it in front of a live studio audience. So what I'm going to need here is a volunteer. Thank you, ma'am. Welcome to the presentation. That was a nice grab diving across the middle. This is good stuff. Okay. Hey, can I get your name real quick?
Amanda Northrup.
Amanda, and where are you from?
Connecticut.
Connecticut. Okay. Is it fair to say that the economy's changed a bit in the last 5-10 years?
Yes.
Technology in communicating with your consumers a bit in the last 5-10 years?
Yes.
And your heart rate a bit in the last 5-10 seconds?
Yes.
I've got in my hand a set of instructions titled Fear Factor that, actually, Amanda, you're going to go up on stage in front of all of our friends here at the Utopian Summit and to perform that set of instructions. And because we are at the opening of the session, and much of what this year's conference is about is not only creativity but also collaboration, I'm going to do something I don't normally do. And I'm going to now allow you, Amanda, if you'd like, to be the leader of this exercise. And if you would like, you may now delegate or select anyone else in the room that you would like to see hop up on stage and to perform that set of instructions. So y'all have noticed the program has taken a little bit of an interesting dynamic turn here. Yes, smiles almost crept across Amanda's face as blood's returning to her faculties. And have you also noticed that those who just moments ago were kind of giggling or snickering to the thought of seeing you up on stage have all of a sudden quieted up. They're sort of staring off at the trusses, the chandeliers, their shoelaces, trying not to make eye contact. It's fine in marketing. I actually call that its own form of risk management. Amanda, is there someone who you'd like to see hop up on stage and to perform that set of instructions?
Me volunteers.
So just to put it up to speed, Amanda has just asked if there are any volunteers. I didn't see any hands shooting fervently into the sky. Oh, we do have. Okay.
Oh, well, it's your lucky day.
Yeah, you've got a few to choose from, young lady.
You look like you're ready and willing.
Ready and willing. Amanda, thank you very much. You all give Amanda a big round of applause. Your work here is done. Come on, man, come on up. Can I get your name real quick?
Michael Wolf.
Michael, and where are you from?
Overnight Print. Las Vegas.
You're from here in Las Vegas?
I just moved here, yes.
You just moved here. Okay, fantastic. And do you have any experience doing freestyle rapping?
Not today.
Okay. Okay.
Did I look like I was going to be a rapper?
No, you're good. Actually, what I'm going to have you do, Mike, I'm going to take a deep breath. Because I do. I want this to be a moment that you and Amanda and I never forget. I say it with great intention and even great specificity, particularly in understanding general anxiety, in understanding performance under pressure, even in understanding elite athletes and the relationship between the mind and the body, almost understanding breathing patterns in understanding performance under pressure. I also like to give a little bit of a dramatic pause for those of you who haven't yet broken out your smartphone recording device. Yeah, you know that saying, what happens in Vegas goes up on Twitter, right? Yeah, that's hashtag eSummit and Utopia. Go ahead and open that up and read that aloud to our friends here.
Thanks.
The penny of Bono is yours to keep. Congratulations. Right on.
That's it, my friend. You earned it. Your work here is done, my friend. Give Michael a light. It'll be dry and waiting for you at the end of the show. Give him a big round of applause. Sometimes it pays to take a risk, to take ownership and take action on an idea. Now, Michael, I've just always kind of been fascinated at kind of as consumers, where we place value in our lives, even what things we don't value. As an artist, where art generates its value from, and I would just be curious. I've got a $100 here, a Benjamin, that I would be willing to trade you. So I get the Bono painting back, and you get to keep the $100. No deal? Would you do me a favor and give this to our mutual friend Amanda as a thank you for freestyling in our little improv session? But sometimes it does pay to take a risk. Now, I'm in the business of creating disruptive strategies. That's what I do for a living, both as an artist as well as an entrepreneur and a marketer, is I look for ways to defamiliarize the ordinary to create breakthrough opportunities or stories or branding experiences, memorable branding experiences. So one of the things I did is about 7 years ago is I actually stopped selling all of my art. I don't sell it anywhere. I don't sell online. I don't sell in galleries. I don't do commissioned pieces ever for friends or family. And just kind of in an effort to see if I could toy with those traditional economic laws of supply and demand. So then I discontinued all supply to the marketplace, but continued to escalate or raise or build demand through the story of performing for various different charities or for foundations to see if I could look at art or use my art rather as a kind of tool to profit or to transact, and rather as an interaction or a vessel, maybe by which to in some way even lessen the suffering of the world. Well, I was doing a performance painting in Los Angeles for a foundation to end domestic violence. I was at that night I was doing a performance painting of Marilyn Monroe when a young gal named Alicia Moore I ended up outbidding everyone else to take home that particular painting, which wouldn't normally be that big of a deal, other than the fact that she also doubles as celebrity rock star Pink. In front of the global paparazzi, immediately and disruptively escalating the value of every single one of my pieces of artwork across the board overnight. So Michael, you know, I don't know for sure whether you're a fan of graffiti or speed painting or even U2 or Bono himself, but of course, that's no longer really the relevant financial question. The question now is the sole owner of the Bono painting is, for the course of the next 48 hours here with your friends in Vegas, is, are you going to be an art collector or an art broker? So have some fun with that. That's yours to keep and to decide. And you know, you're a practical guy like myself. I can see you're thinking, cool, you know, new artwork. If I do sell that to someone else, how are they going to fit that in the overhead bin on their flight back to wherever they're going? It's fine. I take that into consideration as well. I ship all of my artwork just in these old cardboard boxes, so I wanted to give you the box that I sent it in and then just let you decide, as one person's trash, at some point another person's treasure. Now, you know, as say, every little thing's gonna be all right. Sometimes it pays to take a risk, to take ownership and take action on an idea, because if we were to follow the trail of breadcrumbs in virtually any unmet goal, any unmet expectation, it would almost always lead back to, in some way, shape, or form, that of fear. Fear of the unknown. I saw this acronym years ago. What does fear oftentimes represent? Simply nothing more than false evidence appearing real. Anxiety, worry, concern over those things, which in so many cases we really don't have any business concerning ourselves with in the first place, yet we oftentimes allow those fears to paralyze that creative thought process. Truly, more than anything else, in the future of marketing and reaching your consumers in an increasingly agnostic social, mobile, and cloud environment, I think fear is going to cripple performance. Because truly, what is a creative idea worth? You know, what is the ROI on a disruptive strategy? What are the analytics? What's it worth to expand maybe even our own corporate definition of risk beyond the structured approach to simply minimizing liability and to begin looking at the risk associated maybe with being too structured along the way? I brought this idea with a healthcare client that I've had the privilege to share with, and he was just the mention of the word healthcare in the course of the last 48 months here in the U.S. has just become an incendiary topic, virtually divisive. And they've felt the brunt of this at the core of their organization, this breakdown of trust, the breakdown of their storytelling to not only internally, but also even extending out into their community, into the patients that they were set up and designed to serve. This breakdown of loyalty, this breakdown of trust. Well, they ended up taking a step back, not unlike what you're doing here in Vegas, a step back from the day-to-day efficiencies and what it takes to effectively run, in this case, their organization. They look at the future of their industry, even their own individual companies, if it were a blank canvas with truly limitless possibilities. They end up launching an entirely different marketing campaign altogether. I just quickly wanted to reshare that with you.
I was watching me and my mom watching this movie that made a kid too. The man that was gonna try to punch him, he kicked him down on the ground. But he was gonna kick him, I was on the ground. You know what he did? He kicked him in the penis. He was injured. Injured bad.
That was certainly still providing the highest quality care at the absolute lowest possible price in a heavily regulated, heavily competitive environment. It's still very serious business. But if we take ourselves as leaders, as professionals, as marketers, as parents, too seriously along the way, it actually blocks our own ability by which to be able to perform under pressure. And that's why I think Einstein probably understood the future of marketing best decades ago, even prior to the invention of social, mobile, and cloud, when he said, you know, imagination is even more important than knowledge. That's not to discredit knowledge or experience or analytics or metrics. However, in the greater context of truly driving your overall brand story and unique experience forward, I think it can oftentimes be those past metrics. Sometimes even that past success can end up being two of the single greatest factors that hold you or your brand back. Because you guys know that the way our mind is set up and designed is we've got this analytical, logical problem-solving space of our mind. We've also got this creative problem-solving space. Yet particularly in the Western Hemisphere here as adults, we exist in this analytical problem-solving space the vast majority of our adult waking life. We're almost naturally resistant to venturing out into that uncharted, sometimes feel like it's vulnerable, risk-taking, problem-solving territory. But I also hold to the fact that it's not our fault, because for the most part, we're all taught and trained and disciplined to become logical. From the time that we all first entered school, we were taught and disciplined to take all of our wonderful, cool, multi-dimensional, disruptive-type ideas and then trained to narrow them down to come up with just one correct answer. One standardized response that everyone else sitting in straight, well-behaved rows also came up with that just one singular answer. And then that got a little worse as we became adults or entered positions of responsibility, because on top of that, we were taught to become increasingly operationally efficient, increasingly metrics-driven, and in a lot of ways, increasingly almost busy. So I've been increasingly vocal as I've had the privilege to share this part of my message with the sales and marketing teams around the country, because it's created in a lot of ways a life of paradox. Where we talk about innovation, disruption, creativity, but when it comes time to making a decision or implementing a new plan, we oftentimes revert right back to what has historical precedent, what we've done previously. And I do want to pause for clarity here, because the development of that analytical metrics driven problem-solving space for mind, it's still absolutely necessary, still 100% categorically necessary, but I'd also suggest no longer sufficient by which to engage in this increasingly competitive, rapidly changing social, mobile, and cloud environment. I think we need to come up with new and different ideas that your competitors never even thought possible, that your valued consumers didn't even yet know that they needed, by breaking outside of business as usual. So my presentation is very loosely titled UNTHINK, or the unlocking or unleashing of our mind's capabilities in a strategic corporate sense. But truly, that art of unlocking our mind is couched firmly in the science of reprogramming our brain, the science of twisting a lot of these challenges, some of these frustrations, even some of these opportunities, and looking for ways now to build back into that communication an emotional connection that's going to drive future consumer loyalty.
And the blood will dry underneath my nails, and the wind will rise up to fill my sails. So you can doubt and you can hate, but I know no matter what it takes, I'm coming home. I'm coming home.
I'm coming home.
One thing that you'll notice about me as a very formal presenter on the corporate lecture circuit is that I take a few liberties from the platform here, artistic liberties. You'll notice I'm not afraid to let the mascara run. I'm not afraid to catch a grown man off guard in a business setting and watch him become well, every shed a tear, because it's actually through that accessing of emotion that true breakthrough thinking and storytelling first has the opportunity to open up. When we have even for a moment stepped back from traditional marketing, corporate speak, sales, marketing, return on investment, competitive advantage, differentiation, we begin to open up to just simply the authenticity of emotion, all of a sudden, that is where true creativity and breakthrough thinking first has the opportunity to open up. And one thing I'd want you to know about me personally is that I've not always been an artist. In fact, I just started painting for the very first time in my life after I turned 30 years old. Now, I knew as a kid, I knew as a little boy that I enjoyed painting, drawing, and coloring, but unfortunately, I was told flat out by my fourth grade teacher that I actually was not a very good artist because I didn't color within the lines. Because I went too fast. Because I didn't pay attention to detail. Because I didn't draw the red apple red and the orange pumpkin orange. And unfortunately, I listened to her and I quit. And I set down my crayons, my paintbrushes, and I didn't pick them up again. Really not once for another 20 years. And as I went through, it was at that point, this very academic blueprint for success, this blueprint for what they called academic excellence. I did. I became, I guess, fairly good at knocking out those grades. I became very operationally efficient on figuring out how to just really simply memorize those very homogeneous formulas and then retain the information strategically just long enough so that I could time it and regurgitate it back to my teachers and then my professors. But along the way, I became almost an impenetrable facade of no-nonsense, analytical, business-like seriousness. I didn't have time for stuff like a disruptive strategy or for innovation or the arts or even creativity. If it didn't have a direct ROI on getting a better letter grade, a better advanced degree, a better promotion, or a better paycheck, I really didn't have a great deal of interest in it. So it wasn't until a series of events that happened in my own life, both personally as well as professionally, that it really rocked the core of my foundation. Because everything that I'd worked so hard, even at that point, so predictably and so successfully towards building up, all of a sudden and unexpectedly spun out into my business, went into a financial freefall following the dot-com bomb. And for me, it was gut-wrenching. It made me physically nauseous because everything that had been built and programmed and trained into my hard drive about what it meant to be successful, what it meant to do or be or even call myself a man, I felt like was taken from me. And I think looking back in retrospect, probably what disgusts me the most is somehow, somewhere along the way in this system of regulation and compliance, is I allowed my self-worth to be directly tied to my net worth. And as one evaporated, so did two go the other. I was completely lost. I was almost rudderless, wrestling with this nightmare of a paradigm. And a friend of mine who's a behavioral psychologist was at first just kind of observing me from a safe distance. how does this subject deal with loss? Before he got scared and he stepped in almost in a state of emergency. He said, Eric, you've got to disconnect from this, if even only for a moment, for your own safety, your health. He said, he recommended that I go and that I, you know, travel. Or that I do something as a cathartic or almost therapeutic release to break this downward spiral. I just lost everything that I had. I didn't have any disposable income by which to go and travel. So it was really probably by financial default, maybe as much as anything else, in an effort even just to get him off my back, that I went and bought a brush and some paint, went into my garage and went through the motions of physically putting paint on canvas. But at that point of physically putting paint on canvas, that all of a sudden the right side of my mind, that side that had been intentionally repressed or almost held dormant for so long, all of a sudden began to creep open a little bit. Again, I began to see a lot of these challenges that were taking place in my life a little bit different. In fact, I began to see a lot of those core formulas, strategies, best practices that I'd worked so hard to memorize in business school. And I began to see them really from a little different perspective. And that's really where this presentation was born from. Now, certainly, please don't mistake this as a battle cry for you all to quit your positions as, you know, CMOs and marketers for your brands and grab paintbrush and start splashing around the country. You know, frankly, I don't need the competition. But what it is a reminder that concept of truly creating a disruptive strategy, truly differentiating from the competition, that concept even of creativity itself, I think has been wrongly diagnosed as being a genetic trait that we either were born with or without. I hear a lot of adults or professionals or even, you know, sometimes parents use language like, I can't even draw a stick figure. You know, I don't have a creative bone in my body. But no, what I've found, what I've not only researched and written about, but also experienced real time in my own life, is that it's a practiced and disciplined skill that every single one of us in this room has access by which to be able to tap into. So no longer is the question, like I sort of opened up in jest, you know, when I, you know, said, hey, who here can draw? Because deep down, I think we've all known the answer to that question since we were all little kids. I think the question for this morning, the question for this year's utopia is actually how. How are you going to reawaken that childlike imagination? How are you going to reignite your own artistry as a marketing director, as a conductor, as a maestro of your orchestra, to harmonize those notes, that data, those analytics, and the space between those notes to create a truly authentic and unique and emotional and genuine experience for your consumers going forward? So it's about this time in the presentation when most people realize that this really wasn't a presentation about art at all, but rather it's about the psychology and the science of performance. And it's not really a story about me or what happened as a fourth grade student, but rather I'm just simply holding up the mirror. And it's a story about what's happened to you. And it very well might not have been a teacher. It might have been something relationally along the way, something academically, something with your own health or a family member's health, where all of a sudden our natural creative spirit is stifled a little bit. Maybe it's just even the corporate environment itself has stifled some of the creativity that we've had welling up from the time that we were young. So it's not a matter of learning or studying or adding one more thing to your already busy schedule. It's a matter of re-remembering what you already know to be true. Because this idea of imagination as being the starting point for breakthrough thinking, the starting point for game-changing differentiation from the competition and authentic, unique brand experiences for your consumers means a lot to me, because one of my personal heroes subscribed to that theory. And although he, in a lot of ways himself, was labeled and even almost disabled at a fairly early age, because he was practically told flat out by the system and the structure around him that he would not be successful. He really couldn't be successful because he didn't think exactly the way everyone else thought. He didn't act exactly the way everyone else was really supposed to be acting. He went on to use that little bit of difference, that different way of seeing and even experiencing the world, to create extraordinary opportunities simply by seeing the world, really, just through different eyes. Arguably one of the greatest creative minds throughout all of history, ended up saying this quote about what creativity, innovation, and even success meant to him. He said, creativity is really nothing more than seeing logically what the rest of the world around us physically sees with our eyes, but yet thinking really like no one has ever thought before. I think that's exactly what creativity, innovation, and truly differentiating as marketers are going to look like going forward. See what those around you see. But to have the courage, like Albert Einstein did, to twist that landscape and to unthink like no one has ever thought before. And I think that is the art of marketing. Thank you guys very much for the opportunity.